Good morning, everybody. A warm welcome to all of you for worship today. It's great to see so many of you today, and a special warm welcome to visitors who've come to worship with us today. We've just got a few little things with the... We've had some technical issues this morning. We're starting a bit late, but that's okay. I'm sure God's not concerned what time we start. But we're all together, and we're here to worship God, and we are here to receive from what He has to give us as well. So we pray you be blessed by today's service. We've just started for Lent a sermon series and Bible study series on Exodus. So today we'll be looking at Exodus chapter 2 and 3. So if you're new to all that, I'll give a little bit of context of how all that connects together. But we're certainly blessed in the way God is speaking to us through that. So we look forward to hearing what God has to say in the message today as well. Okay, let's begin, folks. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. We boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please remain standing as we open in worship today and sing, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer." Please be seated, everyone. Good to hear everyone in strong voice this morning. We now come to that part of the service where we just give everything we need to give to Jesus. Whatever's built up in the week, whatever struggles or failures or sins or things like that that are burdening your hearts, this is that time to give them to Him so He can forgive us and refresh us. We confess to you and to one another and before the whole company of heaven that we have sinned in our thoughts and in our words, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not always turned our hearts towards you and have often gone our own way. Lord, deep down we know that we truly need you, and we lift up our hands to you for your rescue from our trials and suffering. You have confessed your sins. The cross of Christ is not just a reminder of Jesus' death, but is the mark of forgiveness you received at your baptism. As precious, redeemed, and loved children of God, I announce his grace to all of you. On behalf of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's have our Bible readings.
The first reading for today comes from Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 to 7. The Israelites put God to the test. The whole Israelite community set out from the desert of Sin, travelling from place to place as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. So they quarrelled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses replied, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to the test?" But the people were thirsty for water. For water there, and they grumbled against Moses. They said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and our livestock die of thirst?" Then Moses cried to the Lord, "What am I to do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Go out in front of the people, take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. I will stand there before you by the rock of Horeb. Strike the rock, and the water will come out of it for the people to drink." So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading comes from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. Hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The gospel for this morning comes from John chapter 4, beginning at verse 5. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon when a Samaritan woman came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" And his disciples had gone into the town to buy some food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming where you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshippers must worship in the Spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming, and when he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, I am he." Just then his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, "What do you want?" or "Why are you talking with her?" And then leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I've ever done. Could this be the Messiah?" And they came out of the town and made their way towards him. Meanwhile, his disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you know nothing about." And then his disciples said to each other, "Oh, could someone have brought him food?" "My food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Don't you have a saying, 'It is still 4 months till the harvest'? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now the one who reaps draws a wage and harvests a crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. And thus the saying, 'One sows and another reaps,' is true. I have sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor." Now many of the Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I've ever done." So when the Samaritans came to him and they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. And they said to the woman, "We no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Saviour of the world." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. Please remain standing as we confess the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated, everyone. Well, dear friends, our message today, we're going to be looking at Exodus chapters 2 and 3, not those full chapters, but mainly the first part from verses 1 to 10, and I'm going to read that to you. For those who are visitors, we've entered this part of the story where we're looking at the theme of water, specifically Moses in the basket along the water and his rescue by Pharaoh's daughter. That's sort of the story we're looking at. But last week we looked at all the bad news about the situation of oppression and slavery that Israel was going through, plus the genocide that was happening, all these baby boys that were threatened to be drowned and all those sorts of things. So this part is the redemption part. This is the beginning of the rescue that God has. So we're going to be looking at the theme of water, as you've already heard from, we've heard a lot from Jesus about the water, as he himself is the water. But I guess for Exodus, we're seeing the theme of water being the waters of death that need rescuing. So it's quite an interesting contrast that we're seeing today. Now, let me just read a few verses of chapter 2, and then we shall begin. Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him for 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch, and she put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river. And while her attendants walked beside the river, she saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. And when she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. This must be one of the Hebrew children, she said. And then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Well, shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. And when the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses because, she said, "I drew him out of the water." Grace and peace to you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, I'd like to have a bit of a dialogue with the young people. We have Sunday school today, but I want to talk to you just for a couple of minutes, and then I'll prompt you to leave in a second. I've got a picture of a little visitor. Right, how many of you have seen one of these little creatures? It's a frog, isn't it? Yep, in a swimming pool. Yep, you have? Right. Is it just the once, or have you seen a few over come in and out over the time? You've seen a few. Oh, that's interesting. Okay. Yeah. It's Do you think it's a common occurrence to have a frog in a swimming pool? Do you think frogs can tell the difference between a swimming pool and a pond? No, that's precisely the right answer. They can't, which is why they end up in there, don't they? Well, this little frog, it's rather a sad story about frogs. Because you think, oh, great, that's interesting. There's a frog in our pool. I don't know how they can put up with the chlorine, by the way. But they hop into it in the night time. And you advise not to put the lights on at night because that attracts frogs because they can see the water. And they hop in. And they obviously might want to lay some eggs and do all the things that frogs like to do. But we forget this one simple feature, especially in this picture. It's lined with tiles and bricks, usually. Or if you've got one of those sort of almost different type of pool, might be plastic or whatever. But we forget that the frog can't get out. No, he can't get out. So this particular frog had been swimming all night. And what do you think happens to frogs who are trapped in a swimming pool? What do you think, kids? If you leave them there long enough, they do die. How do they die? No, it's not the chlorine that kills them. Sorry? Well, you're getting close. It's a long period of time, but they literally drown from being exhausted from swimming. So frogs swim and swim and swim, and they're trying to stay above because they do need air, but they sadly drown because there's no way out of a pool. All those sorts of things. So what do you think a solution is for a poor frog in a pool? No, it's a solution. What can we do about to make sure these poor creatures, if they do fall into your pool, how can they get out again? What's that? A ladder. Yeah, you're close. A ladder or a ramp. And so what experts say, if you've got a pond or wildlife, or you're living near other bodies of water, just put a little bit of hose or a little bit of plastic so that if a frog falls into your pool, he can swim up to the ramp and hop back out again. It's an easy solution, but you do not want a dead frog in your pool. Okay, they cause a mess, and there are other issues which I won't go into. But it's really interesting with this little frog, and I like to say this is a picture of the people of Israel. They are drowning in sorrow and slavery and are having a really rough time. And they are like swimming constantly, trying to keep afloat. And they've got no way out. There's no way out of their predicament. And they need a ramp. They need a bridge. They need something to hang on to give them hope. And so that hope comes in Moses. Moses is floating on the water, isn't he? He is the instrument of salvation for the people of Israel. And just like Jesus came down to be with us and became a human being, he is our bridge, isn't he? Jesus is our ramp. He is our hope. He is the way to get out of this predicament of death. And we have our hope on him, don't we? So you can always rely on Jesus. Whenever you have the trials of suffering or you feel like you're drowning in your problems, Jesus is there as the ramp. He is the bridge. He is the way out of that situation. Thank you, kids, for your engagement on that. If you want to go to Sunday school, you're very welcome to go now as we keep moving. Thank you. So we've got this theme, folks, of Jesus as the ramp, as the bridge. Moses is a bridge, and God uses him to rescue his people. Now, Moses' name has a special meaning. We've got a bit of an introduction to that in our text, actually. In Hebrew, his name means one who draws out. Pharaoh's daughter prophetically names him in this way, completely unaware that God, just like Pharaoh's daughter, will come down to the waters, see the people of Israel, helpless and crying like baby Moses, feel compassion and sorrow for them, and will draw them up out of the water to safety. Have a listen to verses 5 and 6 and take note of these verbs that are used to describe Pharaoh's daughter's actions. So it says, the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her slave girl to bring it. And when she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying and she had compassion for him. Now have a listen to the next chapter in chapter 3, verses 7 and 10. This is God speaking. And just watch how similar God speaking is to Pharaoh's daughter. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying because of their slave drivers, and I know their suffering. That's God's deep compassion. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and bring them up out of that land, to draw them up out of the water into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Isaiah 63:11, when talking about Moses and the Exodus, uses this same sort of language of bringing up and out. Then he remembered the days of old of Moses and his people. Where is he who brought them up out of the sea with the shepherds of his flock? So what we hear here in chapters 2 and 3, we hear of God's deepest compassion and care, and the bridge of rescue and salvation is laid down for drowning Israel to have hope. It is also interesting to note that with all the aspects of the text showing us the vulnerability of baby boys threatened with death and genocide, Moses' vulnerability and helplessness in the basket, and later in chapter 4 with a death threat against the firstborn sons, we actually see women being used as agents of salvation. We have the midwives, we talked about that last week, saving the baby boys at birth. Pharaoh's daughter rescues Moses. And later in chapter 4, it is Moses' wife, Zipporah, that in that very difficult and strange text, who saves Moses from death through circumcision of his son Gershom. So Moses is not only a bridge of salvation and hope, but so too, very importantly, are the women. Fascinating theme going through the story. Now, friends, the song Bridge Over Troubled Waters. Who likes that song? Simon Garfunkel. Wonderful song, very iconic. That comes to mind as I reflect on this text today in the season of Lent. The bridge and rescue from the waters of death is a strong theme of Exodus. And of course, later on in the story, we read about the bridge of the parting waters of the Red Sea that God does to bring the people to safety. But interestingly, Bridge Over Troubled Waters, that was written by Paul Simon. That was written after Paul was inspired by one line in an old gospel song. And this was sung in 1958 by African-American group The Silvertones. And it sings about the themes in the Exodus story. The key line that Paul Simon heard and took note of was this: I'll be your bridge over a deep water if you trust in my name, Mary. Oh, Mary, don't you weep. Paul Simon also named Johann Sebastian Bach's O Sacred Head Now Wounded as a source of inspiration for certain parts of the tune. Paul also said at the time he had no idea how he wrote the song. It just came to him. And it's a bit like the Beatles. These songs just seem to come out of nowhere and they're just remarkable. This song was released in 1969. It was a massive hit in the US and across the world, and it remains iconic to this day. And this song touched the lives of so many Americans who were at the time struggling in troubled waters. The war in Vietnam was raging. President Nixon was president, and the country was still coping with the loss of Martin Luther King the assassination of Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy, who were both killed in 1968. Now, this song has a meaning for me because of a man, which we'll call Harold. It's not his real name. I did clinical music therapy with this man in the UK in prison for just over a year. And in this same year that Bridge Over Troubled Waters was released in 1969, this man, Harold, got involved in a pub fight, and it went totally wrong, which resulted in the death of another man. Harold was sentenced to total life in prison back then. And at age 70, an old broken man, he was referred for rehabilitation services in prison, and music therapy was one of the things that he was earmarked for, and I was working in that prison at that time. Now, Harold was a singer in pubs at that during his lifetime, and he's hoped to sing music again after years and years of isolation reemerged in my offer to engage with him. Bridge Over Troubled Waters was his special, special song, amongst several others, and also Christian ones as well. But in my mind, he personifies the nation of Israel, or even you and me, who might feel trapped and imprisoned in a world with no escape. And so, sadly, my time at this prison had to come to an end, and we had to end our time, our therapy. I'd done many sessions with this fellow. And our last session, he sings this song. He sings Bridge Over Troubled Waters from memory. And he does it so well. And he's so much passion. This is an old, old man singing something from his past. I'm going to play you a track. Just a minute and a half of this, of him singing. You've got the lyrics there on screen. Be warned, he suddenly bursts with volume every now and then. But it's quite moving. So I'd like to share that with you before we finish. Very beautiful stuff, very moving. Harold died in prison, eventually died, years after our time together had finished. Death was his exodus, his bridge over troubled waters. Singing music for one whole year of his prison life was a life-giving gift that I prayed would point to something eternal and hopeful beyond his circumstances. And I know that he encountered the living Christ through music, the one who lays himself down as the bridge over our troubled waters. Jesus not only provided himself as the bridge to a new life in eternity for those who have faith in his name, but he is also our constant bridge of hope in the troubled waters of all our life situations. One of the comforts we can take out of the Exodus story today is God's closeness to us in suffering. I know their suffering, is what God says in verse 7. In Hebrew, this is the word yada, which it is, means to know, which isn't head knowledge, actually, but it's experiential, intimate knowledge. So to know in Hebrew is a word about union with another person. Like in Genesis chapter 4, Adam knew his wife Eve and she conceived and brought forth Cain. It's that sort of knowing. Now when God knows your suffering, it means he's in union with it. He is not just sitting back and watching from afar, but the suffering he feels in his heart forms a key part of his agency, his actions, and also his own patience in suffering with you as he works on a solution and a rescue. It is really important that God knows you, that your suffering is also his suffering. Israel's suffering was God's, Harold's was God's, and of course your suffering is God's also. But your baptism is also a source of hope and strength when the storms and troubled waters happen. And we can easily be deceived, can't we, into believing that things are so bad and so linked to our mistakes that we will perhaps never gain relief or rescue from God. Our baptism reminds us of our identity, that we are God's children. Baptism does not fade in and out of its relevance or power to comfort us according to our circumstances. And it is, as Martin Luther says, like a ship. It's a sturdy vessel that we live in, that is taking us across the sea to the golden shores of eternity. And so when we live in our baptism, we have that safe assurance that God's claim of us never diminishes. He is in control, he loves us, and he won't abandon us. So God's voice in all our trials just tells us to stay focused on him. He's working on a situation, on the situation, and help is on the way. Thank God for sending Jesus, the bridge, his precious son, who lays himself down over troubled waters so that we can walk confidently forward and in strength as dearly and preciously loved children of God. And as Jesus in his baptism came up out of the water, may we too be reminded that we are like Moses, drawn up out of the water and into God's glorious light and the safety of his arms. Amen. Dear friends, we're going to sing now. We have our offering song, I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say. And as you sing, the offering plate will go around. If you would like to give, you're very most welcome to. Thank you. Thanks, band. That was great. Let's say a prayer for our offerings, folks. Dear God, we thank you for your constant provision for us, your rescue from all our troubles and dangers. Lord, you do so much for us, and Lord, with open hands, we receive your goodness. But today, Lord, through our offerings, we want to give to you as reflections of our love and devotion to you. But we also ask for our offerings to be used by your Spirit to widen and strengthen your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Dear friends, I invite you to bow your heads and close your eyes as we pray together and connect with our Heavenly Father and give to him all the things that we want to pray about, especially for our church and one another and also the world. Father God, you gave us the gift of your Holy Spirit in the living waters of baptism. You called us to pray to you as our Father. We pray to you in the name of Jesus for your church, the world, and also those in need. Thank you that Jesus gives us the living water of his saving word and holy baptism that saves us from the waters of death and separation and help us to stay close to him and know that he is with us when troubled waters are all around, and that he is the bridge and the way and the hope we have in all of our trials. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, bring justice to people who are wrongly treated by others. Curb all violence and crime and bring peace to all nations and all communities. Teach our world the truth about marriage and promote stable and safe and loving, emotionally healthy families, which are essential to hold the fabric of society together. And give your grace and strength to all parents that they would always seek to serve and forgive each other and pour out your grace and love into their children. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, as we have focused today on the birth of children and especially the role of women in caring and nurturing your little ones, bless and safely give healthy births to newborns in families and strengthen both fathers and mothers in their roles. Comfort and console those who cannot have children and have faced the loss of children. And we lift up today all people who face all sorts of loss, the loss of loved ones, or the loss associated with illness, disability, or impairment. And provide for all in need at this time, and help grant patient waiting to those who long for rescue from their trials. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, you give your Spirit to those who ask you. Pour out your Spirit on us to refresh us and bring us to life in you. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Dear friends, we look forward to the sacrament today, to be fed by the body and blood of Jesus. And we are all weary travellers, aren't we, on life? This is a refreshment stop. where we can receive strength and forgiveness and renewal from Jesus. And so the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord. It is indeed right and good, Lord God, Holy Father, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. He has taken on himself our sin so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. Therefore, we remember him with thanksgiving. Call on your Spirit to come, and with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we adore and praise your glorious name, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup after the supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Amen. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Amen. Dear friends, we're about to have the sacrament and this is the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, in with and under bread and wine. All are welcome to share the table today. If you are baptised and believe in the Lord Jesus, please come and share the meal. If you would choose not to have communion, you're still very much invited to come forward for a blessing. So feel free to do that. Also, we have individual cups, etc. But also a reminder to you, if you would prefer the common cup, that is available. So just let the assistants know when you come forward that you, if you would like that. Now Jesus says, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. The bread that I will give you is my flesh, which I give so that the world may live. Thanks be to God. Come, everything is ready. invite you to stand for that, folks. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life eternal. Go in peace. Amen. Let's pray, prayer of thanksgiving. Compassionate God, we thank you for sending your Son to suffer and give his life for us and to make us your people. Teach us who have received his body and blood in this holy meal to forget ourselves and rely only on Christ our Saviour. For he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Well, folks, let's remain standing. It's been a big service today, and we're going to let's end in with big voices. So let's sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Go in peace. Christ has reconciled us to God, and he will save us. In the name of Christ, amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favour and give you peace. Amen.
Good morning, all.
Good morning.
get used to. There's so many people for communion. We've kind of had a queue and which side of the pews to stand on again. We haven't done it for so long. We're all out of practice, aren't we? It's a wonderful thing. Welcome to visitors. The main thing is this last reminder for AGM next week. So there'll be lunch after the service, just prior to the meeting. We'll get through the meeting as fast as possible, but we do want to have enough people for a quorum, so look forward to seeing as many of you as possible there. And we're not going to embarrass him, but happy birthday to Jonah. Congrats on that next milestone, and I'll see you after. I thought Danielle had something to say. It was like, don't raise your hand at the auction, isn't it?
Great. Have a blessed day, everyone. Greet you at the door, and peace be with you all.